It's my great pleasure to welcome Christine Lowe, Under-Secretary of the Environment in the Hong Kong Government. She's been recognised in the Peter Bryce Award for Outstanding Civic Work and named Woman of the Year by Hong Kong Business. Today we'll be discussing Hong Kong's environmental initiatives and whether the city can importantly influence national policy on the mainland and how the public and private sectors can participate to effect widespread change. What are the strengths the city has and what are the potential shortcomings we have in addressing the challenges that we've identified?
Well, let me just make one general point. Like any other city or any other region in the world, there are things that we can control ourselves. That means if you work hard within your jurisdiction, you can do a lot. But then there are regional issues, things that come from your neighborhood. Now, obviously, to deal with that, you need to think of how to collaborate with your neighbors. And obviously, in Hong Kong, Richard, as you've put it, the black sheep of Hong Kong, usually the poster child, right, where people hold up, is air quality. Because everybody needs to breathe so many times every minute, so we can't really escape from that. So that's a good place to start. First of all, what we're doing ourselves, and secondly, what's our neighborhood? And I just want to say here very briefly what the Hong Kong government policy is today. First of all, is to work hard to clean up our own pollution. Secondly, is to collaborate with the stakeholders in the community because, you know, you're going to need political support and you're going to need business support to do some of the things you want to do. Thirdly, is for your solutions to be evidence-based and then to work with your neighborhood. But because we are a part of China and because air pollution is now a very, very major priority for the Chinese government, we have the opportunity to also work nationally with the environmental protection and other relevant authorities.
And if we've defined then the roadmap as to how we want to approach the opportunity, you know, where are the strengths the city has? I mean, clearly, it's been a journey to where we are today. There's work still to be done. But what do you think the city has in its favor? Mm. And what are the things that we need to work on in order to, you know, maximize the probability of success on the environmental opportunity?
Hong Kong has a number of very significant advantages. That's not to say we don't have disadvantages, but let's point out where we are, that where we are good. Number one is actually we have a government where rule of law is important. That means under the common law system, we are regulating many things. I mean, obviously, laws need to be constantly adapted for the future and so on. But, you know, our environmental framework in Hong Kong, it's not bad. Secondly is when we decide to do something, and we're often criticized for not doing enough, but when we decide to do something, usually the action part, actually getting it done, Hong Kong is quite strong. Thirdly is we have a strong private sector. And, you know, there's always this discussion about vested interests, you know, how can we get them to change sooner rather than later? But actually, we have a very competent private sector. If they decided to move and we agree on what's the way forward, we can move pretty quickly.
Okay. Maybe then, turning back to air, could you maybe give us a state of the union on where we are on air quality in Hong Kong, where we are in terms of air quality in our adjacent neighborhoods on the mainland, and you know, what are the key initiatives we're working on to address the air quality opportunity?
What I want to show you is just a few slides, the pictorial story. Now, these are annual concentration of pollution in China. And if you go back to 2002, what you're really seeing is there's already actually a lot of pollution. And you might remember a time both in Hong Kong and on the mainland where people talk about haze. So haze has been a serious problem in China way before 2 years ago when people started talking about smog and PM2.5. So actually, we've had the problem in China for a long time. So we go to 2013, 2014 is about the same. Now, what you want to notice is where the pollution is most concentrated. It's really in the north. If we look at the south, which is where we are, this is Hong Kong, Guangdong, and this is a picture of the Pearl River Delta. It tells a very interesting story because, again, let me go back to the last one. You can see that actually in the south, it's not as polluted as in the north. That doesn't mean we're not polluted. It just means that, relatively speaking, and everybody's focusing in Beijing, all the photographs that goes around the world, is of the north, northern part of China. We're comparatively lucky in the south to have lower levels of pollution. All right, now this story is very interesting. You can see from 2000, and you can see that up till about 2006, 2007, Guangdong has increasingly poor air quality. But then you see from 2008 onwards, actually things have improved. And in 2012 and 2013, the pollution in Guangdong province has been much improved. Now, this is a story that has yet to be told. Guangdong is actually incredibly proud of what they've done in the last 5 to 6 years. Now, Hong Kong and Guangdong has been collaborating on air pollution control since 1999. And in Hong Kong, our worst air pollution period was around 2003, 2004. So a whole range of things have been done in collaboration with Guangdong. Now, the question, of course, today is, do we know what are the major sources of pollution? So if you want to control better, you need to know where it's all coming from. Now, I know this is not very clear, but you kind of get a sense of the different pollutants, where they're coming from. So Hong Kong and Guangdong together have the longest record of the most reliable measurements of air quality. So Hong Kong and Guangdong, we continue to work together. We've also agreed on reduction targets. This is the second round of targets. In 2012, we've agreed on the second round of targets. By the end of this year, we're going to review how we've been doing between 2012 and 2015, and we're going to see how to set or firm up targets for 2020. So what's interesting about the Hong Kong-Guangdong story is this is a regional collaboration plan, and other parts of China, for example, Shanghai with the Yangtze River Delta, they're very interested that we in the Pearl River Delta have this plan, because you can see that if you were in Shanghai, you're also equally concerned about what's coming from your region. So in a way, Hong Kong and Guangdong, we've defined a path for regional collaboration, and the national government is also very keen on how this can work, maybe in other parts of the country.
How has the government managed the tension between the opportunity to raise revenue but the desire to maintain, you know, an environment in the city where the population can convene and enjoy what is an area of quite natural beauty?
Well, this is a very interesting issue, and it has a history, again, back to about 1994 or 5. For those of you who have been in Hong Kong a long time, or if you're from Hong Kong, you know that we've had various faces over the last many decades on harbor reclamation. And the harbor is much smaller than its original form. And there has been, over the last 15 years, a dramatic change in people's vision of what the harbor should be. Of course, many years ago, it was a working harbor. But today, I think people look at it as a working harbor plus a recreational asset. So I think by cleaning up the water there, that's critical, because if you want to be near the water, you want the water to be nice enough that you don't mind being near to it. So there is now a vision of gradually doing large and smaller bits of infrastructure work so that people can be near the harbor. So this is not under the Environment Bureau, this is under the Development Bureau. And I think they're going to create a harborfront authority to make sure that all of these little and bigger bits and pieces of work are going to be better coordinated.
Okay. What have you been doing with the bus community and the MTR to pursue the opportunities available for environmental impact there?
Well, I think we're agreed that MTR is a very competent company. It's recognized here. I know we have many complaints when, you know, they when there are stoppages and so on. Rail carries about 50% of Hong Kong's total traveling public, and somewhere between 32 and 35% of the traveling public goes in franchise buses. So buses is very, very important as well.
Maybe one last local opportunity for us. We have 40% of Hong Kong is effectively protected nature parks. Pretty extreme opportunity in terms of biodiversity. What are the key initiatives the government's taking to protect this natural resource endowment?
Actually, this map is worth looking at. It means we have relatively little flat land. And that's why we even built the very tall buildings on mountainside. But in total, our developed area, it's only about 20% of Hong Kong. And of the undeveloped areas, 40% of it is protected by law as country parks. As a percentage of protected area, is extraordinarily high for many cities. Now, again, looking at this, Hong Kong has everything. We have water, we have mountains, we have a lot of biodiversity because we're at the cross currents of the colder and the warmer climate. We're now looking at creating marine parks, and you see we already have four. But in the next 7 or 8 years, we're going to have at least another four marine parks that we are going to declare. So there will be a plan coming out in the not-too-distant future where we can collate all the efforts that are going to be made so that people can see how this vision is going to be implemented.
Looking forward, what are the big items on the to-do list, and where does the opportunity lie in terms of collaborating with mainland China to address those opportunities that really transcend the border?
I think air pollution, because China's already got huge plans, and you know we want to dovetail with the ones in China. And just, I think a few days ago, China's come up with the national plan on water. This is very essential, very terrific, and we need to look in Hong Kong again, what role we can play. And I believe in the not too distant future, China will come up with another national plan on clean soil. Now, while that's less relevant for Hong Kong within our own small territory, obviously a lot of our food sources come from the mainland. So again, that's something going to be very, very relevant.
Christine, very sadly, we're out of time. But I'd say to everybody in the room, pardon me, and dialed in from around the region, for anybody that's doubting whether Hong Kong is addressing the issue, I think it's very clear from what we've heard today that at the heart of the government, there are people thinking long and hard about the opportunity ahead, thinking about the policies and opportunities to engage both public and private partnership around technology, around deploying the capital to actually realize the full potential of Hong Kong, not only the gateway to China, but one of Asia's great cities. I think we should all be very excited about the opportunity ahead. With that, I'd like to thank you on behalf of the firm and everyone here for joining us for this Talks at GS in celebration of Earth Month. Thank you very much.
Thank you.